Stephanie Hall. Our project was the dual-use wideband microphone array. Before we get started, I'll introduce the team. So we had Brittany Tillman, responsible for localization. Brandon Fisher, responsible for signal processing. Victor Nanjui, responsible for our graphical user interface. And Chris Bardee was responsible for signal capture and detection. Right now, NASA's only manned space missions revolve around the International Space Station. With Project Orion, however, all that's going to change. Orion will take astronauts higher, faster, and deeper into space than ever before. With this exciting project, obviously, comes unique and difficult challenges. I want you to imagine something with me. Imagine that you're an astronaut on Orion. Your mission is to study an asteroid hundreds of thousands of miles into outer space. You're sitting there, all systems are in the green, all's quiet. You're hurtling through the dark, cold vastness of space. When suddenly, you sprung a leak. Everyone was able to hear that. So if you were that astronaut and you heard this leak, you'd know pretty quickly that something required the entire crew's attention. Now let me ask you a question. What if that leak were completely silent? And that's where our microphone array comes in. This project was put forth by NASA and the Texas Space Grant Consortium. The microphone array will monitor voice between 200 hertz and 6 kilohertz, take that signal and transmit it. Upon detection of an ultrasonic signature above 20 kilohertz, it will process that signal and send an alarm to alert the astronauts. Now, testing was difficult for this project because there is no COTS solution that generates ultrasonic signatures, so we had to get pretty creative. We found some special transducers and were able to fashion our own testing boxes. At 25, 32, and 40 kilohertz. Our results were good. The requirements called out that we test in an 8x10 room to try to simulate a spacecraft. We were able to detect ultrasonic feet in a 23x10. We were able to detect ultrasonic signals in a 23x10 space, and our voice capture was able to capture up to 42 feet. Our graphical user interface has the alarm silence feature, as well as providing a Fourier spectrum analysis and a time domain recreation of our signal. At this point, I'll open up to any questions.
Was the microphone, looks like your test setup was kind of an open space, was that a requirement on you, or did the microphone have to deal with other obstacles that would normally be mounted in it?
The requirement that was given to us was that it had to be MEMS microphones. That's what you see, the four microphones on the front of the box. Brandon, would you like to add anything to
them? The testing space requirements were pretty open for us. There was a general understanding that if you're going to have a leak in a spacecraft, it's going to be on the wall somewhere. We generally don't have issues with obstacles, unless those obstacles are something like an electronic, like a screen or something directly in the way of the leak. And I believe that has to do more with the fact that we're using these particular transducers that are extremely, extremely directional. So they don't propagate, they have a very narrow beam width, and they don't actually propagate as you expect a leak. So in a actual leak situation, we would expect better accuracy of our tech.
You have tested this on Earth, so what can be some of the interferences that can take place in spaceships in the interstellar space?
Some of the challenges with that were, in case a, say, vacuum pump or other piece of equipment operates at and displaces an ultrasonic frequency, one of our stretch goals was to monitor for that first, take those signals, save them, and then be able to alter a kind of baseline. Those were stretch goals, and we didn't quite make it that far.
Stuff that you're project today, what would you be tracking?
I'm sorry, what was that?
If you started the project today, what would you be tracking?
Work faster. I think one of the major things that we lost a lot of time on was we started out trying to use something like an Arduino Mega, a simple microcontroller that we were more familiar with. We ended up changing to a C2000 because these initial microcontrollers couldn't meet the large sampling requirements we have. So because we've got four microphones and we're taking in ultrasonic signatures, we need to hit at least 200,000 samples a second on four microphones simultaneously, as close to simultaneous as possible. So I think that would be the major thing that we would do differently, is we would start out with a more capable controller.
Would you have a testing requirement of detection? Does that mean it's 100% detection?
All
test cases?
We have, it's difficult for us to reproduce an ultrasonic leak signature, because from what we can tell, it requires a very large pressure differential. We've been able to get pretty close with things like the compressed air canister, which will have some ultrasonic noise. So we have 100% detection with the transducers we have. Because they're so high frequency, there doesn't exist something like a sound pressure meter that'll operate at, say, 50 kilohertz, at least not that we can get a hold of. So, sometimes, and this is more of a connection thing, sometimes if the array is jostled, you'll see a temporary alarm state, but it will always recover from that.
Both beam width is important.
On the beamforming accuracy, we do not have solid data. Beamforming requires a lot of calibration and a lot of testing. It would be dishonest for me to tell you that we could tell, you know, say that we had 90% accuracy or something like that, because it's going to require a lot more testing and calibration than we've done right now.
Is there the ports that you use, whether you can use in space for additional hardness and noise?
Chris, what was the question on the part?
Should we consider
the radiation hardness, all the aspects come from space, because other than that, you're still getting false positives more frequently than you know.
No, we didn't take that into account, and that's something that our partner that we worked with at NASA mentioned at the beginning of the project, is that, well, I mean, if it's something that's actually going to go out to space, there are requirements for that. But the direction that he gave us was that this is really just proof of concept. So if you can get something that will work here on Earth, then and if we need to develop it further, then those factors will be taken into account.
Okay, let's thank the team.